So, let's talk about Karin Kallmaker. She has written more than 30 fiction novels for lesbians, including multiple Goldie and Lammy Award winners. Her best-selling works span romance, erotica, and science fiction. She can do it all. I wouldn't be surprised if there were jingles. Her work has been translated into Spanish, French, German, and Czech. More than 6 short stories have appeared in anthologies from publishers like Allison, Circlet, Cleus, Oldstruck, Yellow Rose, and Hayworth. Her writing career began in 1989. Anyone remember 1989? With Naiad Press, where she was fortunate enough to work with Barbara Greer and Donna McBride. Catherine Forrest was her first editor and continues to edit her recent works. She has also worked with numerous other editors and during her tenure as editorial director for Bella Books, so she knows a lot of aspects of this publishing world. So she is really a good person to ask all these questions of. She is a rare California native. She and her partner are the mother of two. She blogs, and please go see her blog at Romance and Chocolate, and apparently is quite pleased to be descended from Lady Godiva. Please welcome Karin Kallmaker.
First things first, a big shout out to Luann. The store is not normally open on Sundays, and she opened for us to have this event.
Yay!
Shameless guilt point, buy something. Even if there's some awesome resistance postcards, whatever it is, buy something on your way out. Support the bookstore so it's here for all of us, for all of you, because we need it now more than ever. So we're going to have a two-part program. There's 6 of us. We're all going to read something short, and then we're going to transition really quickly and start talking amongst ourselves and answer questions about publishing and why we do what we do and all of those good things. So our first reader is going to be Dr. Pol Robinson, not that kind of doctor, who is a displaced Wisconsin, born and bred, so this to her, I'm walking around freezing. She's, of course, shucking coats every time we go anywhere. She's a Badgers and Packers fan and now living in the Seattle-Tacoma area, so, the resistance is back there. And has come all the way from Seattle-Tacoma area, where she's currently a professor. And living with a house full of dogs and her partner. So I'm going to turn it over to Polly. I think she's going to read something for you that is not yet published. Woo! I'm not really checking my email. I have a stopwatch. You know, this is the one published book that's out, and I'm in, not that one, I'm in that one. I'm not in trial by fury, apparently. So I'll throw this up here and watch it fall down. Okay. Let's have some fun. Step on the podium. Okay, this is, I wore my romance socks just for this, by the way. This is a romance set in Ireland. Okay, so Grace O'Malley has come to Ireland to research music history and is based in Dingle, a small village near the sea. The rest pretty much speaks for itself. Grace watched mesmerized as Anne's hand slid along the neck of the fiddle, fingers flying in concert with the blur of the bow sizzling across the strings. Bright and quick and bright, soaring high notes, danced flirtatiously with the wheezing cry of Sean's squeeze box and counterpoint to Jamie's bright guitar. The fiddle's laughing voice wove in and around the other two, almost too fast to distinguish one from another. The music filled the room, underscored by the hum of quiet conversation. The call of the fiddle pulled a man and a woman to their feet into a small open space in the center of the room to dance along. Several people began to clap and laugh as the old gentleman spun his wife in a happy jig, effortlessly performing the complicated steps in time to the tune. Tim leaned across the bar and called out to the dancers, "Oh, it's the O'Shea, is it? Well, boyo, go on then." The man grinned back and lifted his arms to give his wife another spin, then led her in a circle, hands linked at the waist, feet flying in tandem. The woman gave her husband a saucy wink and a nod as Jamie shouted encouragement, giving a yip as he changed key. Anne's grin widened as she raised an eyebrow in challenge. The old woman caught the exchange and shouted, "I'm with you, girl, let's go." Anne nodded and stepped up the tempo as she changed the tune. Grace heard the transition from a jig to a faster reel and laughed out loud as impossibly the two dancers moved to match the musician's increased speed, waving for two others to join them to complete the set. When the tune ended with a boisterous crescendo of blended harmonies, rousing cheers and laughter filled the room as both participants and spectators roared their appreciation. Jamie set his guitar aside and joined Kate and Grace at their table. He lifted his pint and toast to the women as he caught his breath. Slancha, he breathed. Grace toast echoed his toast and leaned back into her chair. She'd fallen into the habit of ending each evening at the pub named, for reasons she'd yet to understand, the Waxy Darvel. She'd been welcomed that first night and the nights thereafter with a warm hello from Jamie, his girlfriend Kate, a stiff nod from their Uncle Sean, and a bright smile from Anne. Be honest, Gracie, she told herself. It's the smile that brings you back. The smile and those eyes. She sighed again. Despite every effort not to notice, to not appreciate, and to not want, she found herself doing all of the above. Sure, a woman noticing and appreciating, let alone wanting another woman in Ireland. That's a great idea, Grace. She snorted into her Guinness, sending a fine spray back up into her face. Kate reached out and touched her arm. All right? Wiping her face, Grace smiled. Yeah, sorry, I was just thinking. Are you enjoying your stay here, then? Yes, I can't believe I've only been here for a few weeks. You've all made me feel right at home. Jamie kissed Kate's cheek. Our Kate loves to help. When Anne came back to us with her broken... Sorry, that's not my story. Anyway, when our Anne came home, it was Kate who did everything, from making beds to making meals. She's a wonder. I agree, Kate, Grace nodded and smiled, but her mind was on Jamie's words. Was he using broken metaphorically? Literally? She looked over at Anne, allowing herself, for the first time in a while, a long, lingering study. She didn't let herself indulge in too many of these. She didn't want to be drawn to her, and she didn't want to be interested. She had so far avoided any extended periods of time with just the two of them. She was afraid that her growing attraction would become obvious and ruin the beginnings of a friendship that was quickly becoming important to her. So she'd made sure to ask Kate along when Anne offered to show her the surrounding area. It was Kate whom Grace had asked for help in settling in, not Anne, though she'd really wanted to. And mostly, Grace avoided spending too much time just simply looking at her friend. Avoided looking for reasons to make Anne smile, to watch her eyes, eyes that were beginning to haunt her sleep. Grace stared down at her Guinness. What had Jamie meant by broken? She looked up from her drink to see those eyes were closed now as Anne began to play a soft lament. The crowd quieted to listen to the first gentle notes of the fiddle. Kate leaned over. It's an old tune called Cardoon, or The Lament of the Irish Maiden. It's about, as so many of our songs are, lost love and war. She's brilliant, isn't she? Yes, Grace whispered, lost in the tune, lost in the magic being woven in and around her. Deep, throaty, low notes resonated with vibrato and spoke of loss, of a sadness that pulled at her spirit, made her feel as if she, Grace, had lost a love to war, that it was her history being laid bare in the music. Pure, achingly sweet cries layered over those sad tones, bending and shaping the lament, gradually climbing high in a ringing call so poignant it might have been spoken aloud. Grace closed her own eyes, self-consciously brushing away the tear that slipped down her cheek as the fiddle's plea slipped slowly down into that melancholy range and echoed with a loneliness so raw and so profound that she felt she'd never be whole again. She opened her eyes and, as the last lovely notes drifted into the silent pub, saw Anne focused only on her, the normal warm, gold-flecked green eyes now dark and intense, her gaze unblinking as she gently set her fiddle and bow aside. Grace's heart leapt and lodged in her throat, and she couldn't get her breath. Around her, the pub came alive again with quiet conversation, but Grace couldn't have said what was discussed. She felt trapped, captured by that piercing, knowing stare. Every shield she'd put in place, every wall she'd built, was gone, all gone.
Jamie has come all the way from Colorado to be here today, and is likely finding it a little warmer here. And what I know about Jamie is that she looks angelic and she writes like a demon. So, and I think she's going to read from us her brand new book. I mean, it is literally off the press, hot and hot in more than one ways. Party Favors.
So just a little bit of an introduction, because this is going to sound a little weird. This book is a choose-your-own-adventure book, and I'm not sure if you guys remember reading these as kids, but it's a choose-your-own-adventure book with an adult theme. I'll just say that. You've made a mistake. Not the typographical there versus there in an email to a boss sort of mistake, but the life-changing kind of mistake that results in a $60 Batman costume rental. 1 week has passed since you told Janine you thought your relationship needed some breathing room. Things had gotten serious too quickly. Surprisingly, she agreed. But a few days later, you couldn't help wondering if maybe you didn't need a breathing room. Maybe you only needed Jean. And when she called to see if you could still meet her at the fancy dress party you'd both been invited 2 months ago, you immediately said yes. Unfortunately, you misunderstood a fancy dress party to mean a costume party. And now you stand in the middle of a marble entryway of a Victorian mansion in the priciest neighborhood of the city. Everyone is dressed in ball gowns and black ties, while you are unmistakably Batman. Costumes have never been your thing, but knowing that this particular party was important to Janine, you splurged. And the complete costume includes Batman's hooded mask that the rental store manager insisted on calling a cowl, a sculpted latex chest piece with upper arm muscles that the Hulk would find impressive, black gloves, a black cape, a yellow utility belt, boot covers, and outer briefs with a mullet jock. You only had to pick out black lycra tights to complete the package. May I take your coat? The doorman asks. His black hair is slicked back behind his ears and a faint mustache lines his upper lip. The tux is impeccable, and if you were actually Batman, he could have been your butler. A smile briefly passes his lips as he adds, I mean cape. What was Batman without the cape? There'd be too much lycra. Your perfectly shaped butt was not going to save you from this evening. No, thank you. I'm not staying. Janine texted that she was running late, and she'll be pissed if you stand her up, but you'll save her pride. You'll save your pride if you leave. And you spin on your heel, reach for the brass door handle. But before you can turn the door handle, the door swings open. Allison Greer walks in, alone. Her dark green gown hugs her chest, and its hem drapes against the marble floor. She slips off a shawl, revealing bare shoulders, and only then looks up to meet your eyes. You imagined this moment countless times. Well, not exactly this moment, but a chance to catch Allison alone. She always has a date, some hot woman who's out of everyone's league except Allison's, or she's in the center of a crowd of friends. Allison stares at you for a long moment, and then before you can slip past her and out the door, she runs a fingertip up Batman's corded abs. Her coy smile stops you in your tracks. Hello, Batman. You make one fine superhero, whoever you are, under that mask. She pauses. When did this become a costume party? Allison's hand lingers on your chest, Batman's chest. Your breath is caught in your throat and words fail you. Dark amber eyes are locked on yours. You wonder if she knows the power she holds over you. Her smooth skin is a shade lighter than her dark brown curls. Her curves could stop traffic. She's cut her hair short since you last saw her. You blame this and the jade earrings dangling from perfectly shaped earlobes for why you can't look away. You're close enough to kiss her full lips, and you wonder if Batman would do just that, but you aren't Batman, and that's unfortunate, because you think Allison might actually kiss you back this one time. We don't know each other, do we? Allison asks. You sense a nervous edge to her voice, as if she's worried that she's flirting with an ex. You shake your head. May I take your shawl? The doorman interjects. You step aside as Allison hands off the shawl, and then someone calls Allison's name. You both turn at the sound. The host of the party, Catherine Flaherty, stands in the hallway with two glasses of wine. If money were a sign of age, then Catherine would be ancient, but she's only 37 and youthful at that. No crow's feet dare to mar her perfect complexion. Good genetics or the time she regularly spends at the day spa are paying off. Catherine glances first at you and then at Allison. Are you two together? Her eyebrows arch. Allison turns to you rather than answer. Her lips part and you stare at each other for one moment too long. You manage to step back, figuratively and literally, from Allison Greer, hoping that she doesn't guess any of your thoughts, and you meet Catherine's gaze. I was just leaving, you say quickly. Wrong party. Of course you can't leave, Catherine says. Nothing even remotely interesting ever happens at these events, and I'm always wondering why. Before you can argue, the door opens again and Janine walks in. She's wearing a red dress with a slit clear up to her thigh, showing off the length of her sculpted legs, and she's been to the salon to add a red streak to her usual light brown locks. Your first thought is whether or not she's wearing underwear. Janine looks you up and down, and then recognition crosses her face. Her nails are manicured, her lipstick's perfect. She cocks her head, and you feel sick as she says your name, punctuated by a question mark. You raise your hand in a timid wave, melting on the inside. Tonight could not have gone more wrong. Why are you dressed like that? Janine asks. Her brusque German accent is even sharper than usual. We're not sure, but I've already told her that she has to say, Catherine says. She turns to Allison and hands her one of the wine glasses. I wanted to snatch you up before the rest of the crowd has you cornered. Catherine slips her arm through Allison's and glances again at you, sweeps an air finger up from your briefs to your cowl. That costume is really quite perfect for something. Come find me later and tell me where you found it. Catherine turns and leads Allison down the tile marble hallway. Janine hands her coat to the doorman, who now has a wide grin plastered on his face. He's not laughing at you yet. You start for the door. Oh, no. You aren't leaving, Janine orders. Her pale skin reddens when she's upset. or embarrassed. Tonight you've probably managed to make her both. Her cheeks are scarlet. You straighten your shoulders and face Janine. Chin up. You think this can't get any worse. Behind Janine, you see Allison. She's halfway down the hall, but she's paused to glance over her shoulder and meet your gaze. Do you? A. Face up to Janine and stay, because you need a glass of champagne and your night can't get any worse. Or B, leave the party with a wave of your cape and an ounce of dignity.
I warned you. Our next reader is KG MacGregor. KG is here from North Carolina.
Woo!
She's come the furthest away, and actually this event is because she said, I'm going to be there, and can we get something together, do something
together?
Yay! And I said, yeah, absolutely. Katie, in addition to, I want to say, more than 24 novels at this point, and a Lambie Award and a whole armful of Bowlby Awards, she's also the president of the Board of Trustees of the Lambda Literary Foundation, which is the foundation that keeps our literature, collectively, all the letters of the alphabet, LGBTQIA, visible and the word spread about them, and also has a great program at putting writers into schools to talk to budding high school writers about creative writing and diversity in our work. So let's welcome KG.
We had quite a war over who was going to follow Karin. And we should have had a war over who was going to follow Jaime. So that would be me. I'm going to read from Trial by Fury. This was this book came out last summer. You probably already read it, so I won't talk very loud. Theo Constantine is a famed women's rights attorney in Atlanta. And drama professor Celia Barone brings her a disturbing case of a co-ed who's gang-raped by several members of the university's championship basketball team. Here, in this scene, they've met at a restaurant to discuss the case, and the conversation drifts from the professional to the personal, and we're in Theo's point of view. Theo sensed it again, the feeling she'd had in her office that she knew Celia from somewhere else. This is totally off the subject, but I can't stop thinking you look familiar. Is there any chance we've met before? Were you ever on one of my juries? Definitely not, Celia said. I would have remembered you, because you're famous, I mean. I forget that. But if we've never met, then you have a twin somewhere. Celia hissed in a deep breath and held it for a second. Okay, it's possible you've seen me before, but it would have been a long time ago, a very long time ago, and I've changed a lot. Okay, now you have to tell me who you are. Well, you know I teach performance studies, right? Acting, stage management, TV craft. Celia twirled her wine glass sheepishly as she spoke. I grew up in LA, and when I was a kid, I had my own TV show on KidStar. The mention of the Children's Network triggered an avalanche of memories for Theo, namely fighting with her brothers over the remote control. Oh my God, your little Cece. I watched you every day after school. I can't believe this. I wanted to be just like you. No, no. You wanted to be like her. She was a Hollywood illusion. Sorry to crack the fantasy, but the real Cece was a screwed up kid from the showbiz cesspool. And like most kids whose mothers hoard them out to Hollywood, home was a cesspool too. Well, by now, Theo wanted every last detail. I always wondered what happened to you, and why the hell did they cancel your show? It was the biggest thing on TV for girls my age, and all of a sudden it just vanished. Celia brazenly cupped her breasts and lifted them. Because little Cece started getting these boobs when she was 11. Seems the network brass didn't want an after-school show about puberty. Theo had already noticed those breasts, how they strained against her sweater. Seriously? You had your own TV show and you're complaining about it? That's every kid's dream. Trust me, it isn't what it's cracked up to be. Imagine being 8 or 10 years old and working all day on a set where everybody forgets that you just want to play with your friends and watch TV yourself. And your mom feeds you carrots and celery for lunch so you won't get fat and lose your gig. I was the golden goose, the one who paid the mortgage. That's a lot of pressure for a kid. Theo noticed that the animated expressions and powerful voice were still the same after 30 years. At least they seemed that way, as she ticked off her favorite episodes in her head. So here I sit, a fangirl meeting her idol. And you're not going to believe this, but watching your show is what made me realize the world treated women differently. Remember that episode about the baseball team? The boys kept jumping in front of the girls to make all the plays, and then one of them snatched the ball out of your hands before you could throw it, and you got all the girls together and told them just to stand around. And the boys ended up having to beg for your help, and then you made the game-saving catch. Celia laughed and nodded along. I remember, but again, that wasn't me. That was little Cece. The real Celia never played baseball a day in her life. Well, this is going to take some getting used to, Theo said. It's not every day I get such a blast from the past. Seriously, what happened after your show? Did you work on anything else? Not that anyone would remember. At least I hope not. Ever hear of Bloody Night in Hell? It was a teen slasher flick, and unfortunately, I did the sequel, too. I missed those. Theo couldn't resist scribbling the title on her notepad, but I'm going to download them this weekend. Oh, please don't do that, for your own sake. You'll never get those 4 hours back. The more you protest, the more determined I am to see them. Admittedly, she'd never been a fan of the horror genre. Too much violence against women. Except, I don't suppose you're naked in any of them. Thank you.
Nice. Next up we have Heather Rose Jones. Slight change of gear. We've got some of my absolute favorite lesbian fantasy writing. And the other thing I want to give Heather a shout out for is a project of hers and her blog called the Lesbian Historic Motif Project, where she looks for the subtext that's in all of the ancient literature, the medieval literature, and in poetry. If it's there, she has divined it out and she writes it up, and it's there for anybody. It's great story prompts. It's wonderful for imagination based anyway. So that's a labor of love that she's been doing for a number of years. And I think Heather's going to read from Mother of Souls, right?
Project. It's actually more of an annotated bibliography of scholarly research on lesbian motifs in history and literature. So it's not my own original analysis, it's me summarizing other people's publications. So I'm going to be reading from my historic fantasy novel, Mother of Souls. This is set in the early 19th century in an invented country of Alpenia. And all you need to know about it at this point is that Serafina has come to Alpenia to study magic. And she is enjoying a brief passing affair with Olympia, who is a portrait painter who also has a certain amount of magical talent. The thin winter sun struggled through the narrow window in Olympia's bedroom, such that the late afternoon seemed more like dusk. The sunny rooms were reserved for painting. Serafina rolled over and squinted, trying to gauge the time. "Must you go?" Olympia said. She twined their legs together and buried her face in a loose cloud of hair. "Not yet, but soon." Serafina reached across to adjust the wick on the lamp, bringing a warm glow back to the room, then relaxed across Olympia's body, drawing in her heat against the chill of the room. Their stolen afternoons were a warm refuge against so many things. There was nothing of her failures here, no struggle to find her place. But the mood had been broken, and she sat up in the middle of the bed. The cover slipped off her bare shoulders as she fumbled for a ribbon to tame her hair until she could braid it. "Just like that, don't move." Olympia rolled off the side of the bed and snatched up the sketch pad that was never far from her reach. The instruction was familiar by now. Serafina paused with her hands reaching behind her head as Olympia's hand moved quickly across the surface of the paper. Do all your lovers have my patience?" she asked. Talking was permitted, moving was not. "I'll only visit for one thing, and then he's gone," Olympia said, pausing with her head tilted to consider the work. "And Renotes will never stay still. If I can't capture her in three lines, she's done." "Done?" The last was meant for her. Serafina slid to the edge of the bed and held out her hand to see. It was only a rough sketch, the sort of study that littered the walls of the studio. Olympia had captured her in mid-movement, her elbows akimbo as she gathered up her hair into the ribbon, a single sinuous line following the arch of her back down around the curve of her hip to where her feet peeked up from the jumbled covers, the merest impression of dark eyes and a tilting smile. "You make me beautiful," she said. Olympia took the sketch back from her. "You are beautiful. I make you see it." Mm-hmm. Serafina looked again. It was only charcoal on paper, without the underlayer of Olympia's talent bringing it to greater life, yet it captured something more than a mirror did. "And what would I see if you drew mysteries for me?" A shake of the head. Olympia didn't care to have her work described in mystic terms. "I'd rather learn you the slow way. It's only fair." She gave a little half-smile. "But when they come to you for portraits," Serafina waved her hand out of the studio, where several unfinished works stood under discreet covers, "you give them your visions?" Olympia shrugged. "Sometimes they get a true portrait. Sometimes they only get paint. I tell them it depends on whether the muse is kind, but in truth it's for my own reputation. Not everyone would be flattered by having their soul laid bare on canvas. Once I look, I can't choose not to see, but I can choose not to paint it." Whatever inspired her, whether muse or fancy, when the spirit moved through Olympia's hands, it could open a window even for those with no special vision. They may not know what drew them to the portraits or why one inspired love and another doubt. Serafina wondered idly whether Lucia would see something in the paintings that she couldn't see in her own music. And Margaret, she had one of Olympia's sought-after portraits, but she'd never admitted its hidden power. There was more magic in the world than could be encompassed in Margaret's theology. Someday she would see that. The cold air stirred across her bare skin, and Serafina found her discarded chemise and pulled it on. "Would you like to see my new project before you go?" Olympia asked as she buttoned up her work dress and covered it with a paint-stained smock. There was a mischievous gleam in her eye as she led the way out into the studio. She unrolled a series of pen sketches on the floor, weighting them with this and that. A bearded man astride a dolphin, a woman in Greek robes with her arm draped across the neck of a bull, a dark-skinned man dressed in a skirt of feathers and holding up a colorful parrot. Serafina recognized the pose in the next sketch, and a sense of dread settled in her stomach. She had become more familiar with her body as seen through Olympia's hands than through her own eyes. Her limbs were sprawled across a carpet as they had been across the bed a short time past, but now with a leopard skin draped carelessly for modesty. She thought suddenly of the Queen of Sheba parading on the opera stage, but she, at least, had been given regal dignity. Serafina's eyes traced over her rounded belly, her breasts bare and dark nippled, her arms crooked around a pair of spears, her hair floating loosely and transfixed by a pair of ostrich feathers. Her face, she looked up at Olympia, feeling the painter's excitement and pride like a blow. That's not me, she said. Of course not, Olympia said. It's Africa. I thought I'd arrange them. She stopped. Serafina, what's wrong? Maestro Noth said you agreed to pose. But not, Serafina struggled to find words for her dismay. She fell back on something Olympia might understand. This was private. This was just for you. She hugged her arms across the thin cotton of her chemise, feeling the weight of other eyes. Olympia's voice was suddenly quiet. Serafina, I'm an artist. Nothing that comes into my hands is just for me. I thought you knew that. She reached out to brush away an errant lock of hair, and Serafina drew back. You liked it when I put you in the banquet scene. The painting of the guild banquet had been different. That had been her, Serafina Tallarico, the foreign thaumaturgist. This isn't me. It's not Africa. It's not anything but stage scenery. Serafina heard her voice shaking. It's a painted whore for everyone in Rotendeck to stare at. Don't you think they stare at me already? And now this is what they'll see. When I agreed, I thought it would be different. She realized that the betrayal was not in the exposure of her body, but that Olympia could have looked at her so many times and seen this, seen a jumble of stage scenery and opera props, a dark-skinned canvas on which to paint someone else's fictions. Even without true vision, she had expected more. She hadn't realized she was crying until her hand came up to brush the tears away.
But her pen name is, how do you say that?
Laina,
the little I in there, that's what throws me off, which is a blend of her and her wife's name on books. So we have Anna and Louisa, but Anna's going to be the one reading because she's the one who wrote it. And she, later you might want to ask her about her courtship because she says it's as good as a novel. And up from California, from Southern California, and through all that weather yesterday, and with their twins, so they've made the sacrifice to be here.
Mm-hmm.
novel Return to Paradise. In the first few chapters, Madison Carter learns that she's been let go from a guest ranch that she's been managing. She drives to a town in Northern California to scope out a ranch that she's been thinking of buying and meets a horse who will be your favorite character. I'm sorry that I didn't have enough time to introduce him in this bit. I'm reading from some of chapter 3, where Madison is finding a repair shop at the beginning of chapter 4, so that you can meet her love interest. On the left, I recognize the open door of a bay, and let me start again. On the left, I recognized the open bay doors of a shop and turned, smiling at the small sign that read Rainbow Auto. The mechanic was busy with a customer, so I dropped the gear shift into neutral and waited for them to finish. The garage looked more house than business. A wall of split firewood stacked neatly between posts blocked my view, but somehow I knew that in the summer, with the porch cleared of wood, there would be a pretty cut glass in the upper half of the front door. I shut my eyes, and the image of my young parents standing in that spot flashed into my memory. I'd seen this house before in a small, square photograph. My father's left arm draped around my mother's shoulder, and an infamy stretched out along his right forearm. He held me as casually as someone would hold a football, my face cradled in his hand and my limbs hanging down loosely. I'd unknowingly come back to the place I would have grown up in had Charlie stayed with my mom. My body felt icy cold. I compressed the clutch and started to put the car into reverse, but the mechanic's eyes had found me, and I felt stuck having idled there as long as I had. The customer handed her keys to him, a big guy with a lumberjack beard and a ball cap. It struck me that they were the same height, but while he had a heavy bulk to him, broad shoulders under his jean jacket, she was lithe in a well-cut business suit. Styled almost blonde hair framed her face, wispy bangs, sculpted eyebrows. This was a woman who took care with her appearance. She spoke with her hands and an easy smile on her face. Her posture suggested the homecoming queen, the girl everyone liked and everyone wanted to be with. She continued to stand in the shop when the lumberjack got into her SUV, and I waited for him to pull it onto the blocks, surprised when the white light signaled that he was backing up. He maneuvered around me in the small driveway and disappeared into traffic behind me. I sat uncomprehending as the homecoming queen approached my truck. Lacey. What the fuck? I thought, eyeing the woman in her black truck, not wanting to deal with anything in my business getup. She continued to sit in the driveway, forcing me to leave the relative warmth of my shop. Can I help you? I asked her. I squinted into the cab and she stared at me without speaking. Great, a space cadet. She opened her mouth like she was going to speak, but looked back at the house. She seemed lost. Shop's not technically open, but if it's something simple, you live here? I turned back at the house. What the hell did that have to do with anything? Yes? How long? Look, I wasn't planning on working today. I'm obviously not dressed for it. Did you need directions? This got her brown eyes to focus on me instead of the house. Maybe she was high and drawn to my sign. I heard my friend Hope's warnings about putting rainbow in my business name. She stared at the open bay door as if she was trying to remember why she was parked in front. I got a flat on my way up the canyon. I'm on a spare tire right now and I wanted to make sure it would get me home. Which tire are we talking? This one, she pointed down at the driver's side. I quickly read the information on the tire. You've got a standard tire there, so you're fine to drive on it until you can fix the flat. If you're worried, you can pull it into the garage. I can check the pressure for you. I stepped back and let her put the truck in gear and pull ahead of me, noting a small rainbow sticker on the back window. Well, that changed everything. I decided she must be in awe of how bold I dared to be with my signage in a small town. She had already shut off the engine and was stepping out of the truck to remove the cap from the tire valve, making me feel a little bad about the pothead assumption. I assessed her in a wholly unprofessional manner, admiring her hair so short it stuck up a bit at the crown and would have been boyish on a less feminine face. I pulled the air hose over and checked the pressure, adding a pound before I held out my hand. Long, slender fingers, as feminine as her facial features, surrendered the valve cap. This tire's good to go. I noted with disappointment that she didn't register the brush of my fingertips across hers. This tire's good to go down the mountain, though it would be good to get the one from the set patched up and back on for balance and wear, if it's salvageable and you've got time. Stabilizing herself with a hand on the cab, the woman studied my shop as if she hadn't heard me. When her gaze did return to me, she said, "But you're not open." "Come on," I said, smiling big. "I wouldn't turn away family."
And now you're stuck with me. Woo! I'm going to read from Captain of Industry, which is a book that came out last summer. Here. And it's a scene a little further in with the heroine Jennifer Lamont, who is an actress and has agreed to do a short guest star gig on a sitcom that's filmed in San Francisco. Why not? And so what I want you to picture in your mind is one of those afternoon talk shows that's all women and they're all sitting around the glass coffee table kind of thing. So have that in your head. And after that, it's all self-explanatory. You know why men don't take us seriously? Why none of us ever get a seat on any of the news that airs after 3 p.m.? Jennifer gestured at the semicircle of bare legs as she rose to her feet. Because serious people don't have magnifying glasses in front of their crotches. They have desks. She planted one stiletto against the shin-high clear glass coffee table and shoved. Shoved again. The fine fishing lines that were supposed to help topple the table in the right direction quivered as the sextex pulled, and the damn thing didn't budge. Her four scene mates broke into giggles. Jennifer dropped character. Did someone nail this down? Cut! The director's harsh voice was loaded with annoyance. Filming this episode of Baghdad by the Bay had been a nightmare, Jennifer gathered, the least of which had been finding a last-minute replacement for their originally planned guest star, someone who could get to San Francisco on a few days' notice. Another score for her agent, Bibi, who had found her 2 days of highly lucrative and visible work while touting it as Jennifer saving the day. Meanwhile, Jennifer had given up major R&R at home with two scripts, a novel, and binge-watching the last season of Fargo. It hadn't been hard to do. Her brain was so preoccupied with this Friday's release of Rope and the upcoming media blitz. It was hard to relax, in fact, and it had been hard for weeks, ever since her work on American Zombie Hunters had wrapped up. If anything else was making her restless, she didn't want to think about it. She'd get home tomorrow night, put last-minute things in her already packed bags for the trip back east, and make her flight to New York by 3. Technicians swarmed the elevated set for the show's newsroom, one sheepishly muttering, "We forgot to undo the safety hooks." Ms. Lamont... There we go. That's what I get for not numbering them. I think I'll remember and it never works out. Anyway, Ms. Lamont, Jennifer turned to one of her co-stars. Amy LeBeau was a disarming bundle of button-cute blondeness with a southern drawl. Call me Jennifer, I mean it. Jennifer, the last syllable came out as a soft fuh that Jennifer quite liked. I've been telling myself not to go all fangirl on you, but I can't help it. It's been one of my dreams to work with you. The whole time I was in acting school, I told myself I wanted to be just like you. Caught off guard, Jennifer said, "Is that wise?" I've terrified a few people from time to time, but only when I meant to. Well, who'd want to scare people on accident? You stand up for yourself, and that makes it easy for me to do, too. I ask myself, what would Jennifer Lamont do? Even though she sincerely hoped there were things she'd done that Amy LeBeau would never, ever do, Jennifer was won over. Well, I'll take that all as a compliment. It is. Amy's cute little nose twitched, an irresistible attribute that had won the public heart. You've never been anybody but you. Well, you have to be yourself. Everyone else is taken. I love that quote. Isn't that Oscar Wilde? Y'all crack me up. Places. Jennifer reacted to the director's command by returning to her seat on stage. She was surprised she needed to blink back the threat of tears. She honestly did not know what to make of what the young actress had said. It was true, she had never shied away from admitting she was ambitious. She understood her own worth. She didn't need anyone to like her, only to respect her. And all of that was still true. But there were also the decades of lies that were like chains around her neck and had been lately threatening to choke her. Had adorable Amy not read the gossip pages? Some of it was true. What would Amy say if she knew that Jennifer had walked away from all personal entanglements so she could ignore the emptiness of her life in the closet? It was a very nice closet, complete with professional and material success, but still a closet. Her real need for quiet after a day of work was the excuse she used to keep her personal life empty. While her agent and publicist and fans could be put off with workaholic explanations, she couldn't afford friends. Friends asked questions that she no longer wanted to answer with lies. better to simply avoid the complications of friendship or intimacy altogether. And like a ticker at Times Square, the thought marched across her mind, I'd rather be the person she thinks I am.